Welcome to Anatomy in Nutshell. In this video, we are going to talk about joints of the thorax and respiratory movements. The joints present in the thorax are costovertebral, costotransverse, costochondral, sternocostal, intercondral, intervertebral joints, sternoclavicular, manubriosternal and ziphysternal joints. On the posterior aspect, the intervertebral joints, they are called secondary cartilaginous joint. The costovertebral joints are called synovial joints plane variety. The costotransverse joints are synovial joints plane variety. On the anterior aspect of the thorax, we have the costochondral joints. They are primary cartilaginous joint. The sternocostal joints are synovial joint plane variety, except the first costal cartilage. And the manubriosternal joints are secondary cartilaginous joint. Ziphysternal joint is the primary cartilaginous joint. First, we are going to see the costovertebral joints. They are synovial joint plane variety. The articulation between the the head of the rib articulates with the demiphasate on the two adjacent vertebra. So on the side of the thoracic vertebra, we are having the demiphasates. So the head of the vertebra articulates with the demiphasates of the adjacent vertebra. The ligaments associated with the costovertebral joints are capsular ligament, radiate ligament, otherwise called triradiate ligament, intra-articular ligament. The triradiate ligament, three bands are there. The upper band attached to the vertebra above, the lower band attached to the vertebra below, and the middle band, it forms the hypochondral bow, that is, it unites the either side joints or the ligaments on the two sides. Coming to the intra-articular ligament, the intra-articular ligaments are two plane synovial cavities separated by this ligament attached to the rib on the head of the rib to the intervertebral disc. The next joint is the costotransverse joint. It is a synovial joint plane variety. The articulation between the tubercle of the rib with the transverse process of the numerically corresponding vertebra. It is the tubercle is absent in the 11th and 12th ribs. So there is no joint between the joint in the 11th and 12th ribs. Coming to the ligaments of the costotransverse joint, the same way, the capsular ligament, superior costotransverse ligaments, inferior costotransverse ligaments and the lateral transverse ligaments. This picture shows the ligaments of the costotransverse joint, the anterior and posterior lamina of the superior costotransverse ligament. So the superior costotransverse ligament extends from the crest on the neck of the rib to the transverse process of the vertebra above. The inferior costotransverse ligament from the posterior surface of the neck on the rib to the transverse process of the same vertebra. The lateral costotransverse ligament extends from the lateral non-articular part of the tubercle to the tip of the transverse process. Coming to the costochondral joint, it is a primary cartilaginous joint. Articulation between the costal cartilages and the two ribs. There is no movement. And the sternocostal joints are the first rib with the sternum. It is a primary cartilaginous joint. It's a syncartrosis. There is no movement. Between the second to seventh ribs, it is a synovial joint and freely movable joint. Between the articulation of the second to seventh costal cartilages with the sternum. Coming to the interchondral joint. So the interchondral joints are between the 6th to 9th ribs, they are called synovial joint, freely movable joint. And between the 9th to 10th ribs, it's a fibrous joint, so slightly movable joint. Coming to the manubriosternal joint, it is a secondary cartilaginous joint. Only detail movements are present. The ziphysternal joint is the primary cartilaginous joint. The intervertebral joint. So the joints between the vertebra, the bodies of the vertebra and the superior and inferior articular processes. So the between the bodies of the vertebra, they are called secondary cartilaginous joint, and between the articular processes, they are synovial joint plane variety. Between the bodies of the vertebra, a disc shaped structure present is called the intervertebral disc. It is a fibrocartilaginous structure. The thickness varies between the region of the vertebral column as well as within the single intervertebral disc. So the cervical and lumbar region, it is thicker on the anterior aspect
and in the thoracic region it is uniform in thickness. It occupies about 1/5 of the total length of the vertebral column. Coming to the parts of the intervertebral disc, it has two parts, nucleus pulposus and the annulus fibrosus. The nucleus pulposus is the central part of the disc. It is soft gelatinous at birth. As the age advances, the elasticity of the intervertebral disc reduced. It acts as a shock absorber. Coming to the annulus fibrosus, it is a peripheral part of the disc. The outer zone mainly contains the collagenous fibers. It merge with the anterior and posterior longitudinal ligament. The inner zone contains the fibrocartilage, the fibers forming the lamina, and they are incomplete. They are incomplete rings. In this picture, we can see the merging of the annulus fibrosus with the anterior and posterior longitudinal ligament. Coming to the functions of the intervertebral disc, it gives shape to the vertebral column, acts as a shock absorber. It allows a slight movement of the vertebral bodies, more in the cervical region and the lumbar region. Coming to the ligaments of the intervertebral column, its anterior longitudinal ligament, the afferent extend up to the level of the occipital bone. The posterior longitudinal ligament, the afferent extend up to the level of the C2, that is the second cervical vertebra. Above the second cervical vertebra, it is called the membrana tectoria. And between the transverse process is called the intertransverse ligament. Between the spinous process is called the interspinous ligaments. And the supraspinous ligaments from C7 to sacrum. Above the C7 level, the ligament is called the ligamentum Newkay. With the adjacent sides of the laminas are connected by means of the ligamentum flava. The movements allowed in the vertebral column are the flexion, extension and lateral flexion in the cervical and lumbar region. The rotation movements are more prominent in the thoracic region. The range of movements different in different parts of the vertebral column, as well as depends upon the thickness and flexibility of the intervertebral disc. Coming to the respiratory movements, the lungs expand during inspiration and retract during expiration. The movements are governed by the the movements of the thoracic wall. It in turn increase the volume of the thoracic cavity, produce the negative intrathoracic pressure, which sucks the air into the lungs. And the elastic recoil of the pulmonary alveoli and thoracic wall expels air from the lungs during the expiration. Coming to the principles of the movements, the rib acts as a lever and the fulcrum lies just lateral to the tubercle. The disproportionate in the length of the two arms of the lever, so the slight movements occurs at the vertebral end and the greater magnified movements present at the anterior end. Coming to the pump handle movement, the anterior end of the rib is lower than the posterior end. During the elevation of the rib, the anterior end moves forwards, mostly in the vertebro sternal joints. Along with the up and down movements of the second to sixth ribs, the bodies of the sternum also moves up and down. It is called the pump handle movement. So the anterior posterior diameter of the thorax is increased. So the bucket handle movement, the middle of the shaft of the ribs lies at a lower level than the plane passing through the two ends. During the elevation of the ribs, the shaft also moves outwards. So increase in the transverse diameter of the ribs more occur in the vertebrochondral joints. This is called the bucket handle movement. So the thorax resembles a cone, a tapering upwards. Each rib is longer than the next higher rib. On elevation of the lower rib, comes to occupy the position of the smaller upper rib and pushes the sternum upwards and forwards. So increases the transverse diameter of the thorax. Vertical diameter is increased by the piston movements of the thoracoabdominal diaphragm. The summary of the factors, the anteroposterior diameter is increased by the pump handle movements of the sternum brought about by the elevation of the vertebrosternal ribs, that is 2nd to 6th ribs, and partly by the elevation of the 7th to 9th, 10th ribs. And transverse diameter is increased by means of the bucket handle movement of the vertebrochondral ribs and partly by the vertebrosternal ribs. The vertical diameter is increased by the descent of the diaphragm as it contracts. It's called the piston movement. During inspiration, the diaphragm contracts and it comes down by 2 cm. It is aided by relaxation of the muscles of the anterior abdominal wall. During expiration, the abdominal muscles contract and the diaphragm is pushed upwards. It facilitates an inspiration of at least 400 ml of air during each contraction. The female, the respiration is thoracoabdominal. In males, it is abdominal thoracic type. The muscles responsible for the respiration. Normal respiration, it's a diaphragm, external intercostal muscle and intercondral part of the internal intercostal on the contralateral side. For deep inspiration, adductor spinae, pectoral muscles, skeletal muscles. For expiration, it is a passive process. No effort is needed for the normal expiration. The forced expiration by the muscles of the anterior abdominal wall. Coming to the clinical aspects, in dyspneic and difficulty in breathing patients, in case of lung pathology, the patients are more comfortable on sitting up and leaning forward and fixing the arms. So the diaphragm is pushes downward, slightly downward. So it helps in the comfortability of the patient during respiration. And most prominent role in respiration is played by the diaphragm. Respiration occurs in two phases. Inspiration is by the active phase of 1 second. The expiration, the passive phase of 3 seconds. In young children, the thoracic cavity is almost a circular in cross section. So the expansion is limited. It is called the abdominal type of the respiration. In a woman of advanced stage of pregnancy, the descent of the diaphragm is limited. It is called thoracic type of respiration. Thank you. Watch more videos in the anatomy.